This video is sponsored by NordPass. Oh, this will certainly create some heated debates, but it is a topic that we must be talking about because Election Day is nearing for our American friends, and as you can guess, it could have a big impact on the future of space exploration. So let's analyze a bit closer what a win either for the current president or for the new one would have on NASA, Artemis, and future Moon and Mars exploration.
Then we of course have to talk about SpaceX's current progress on Starship and Super Heavy at Boca Chica, and also about some potential Venus missions, now that the possibility for life there has greatly increased. A lot to cover again, so stay tuned.
Okay, this is going to be difficult. Talking about space politics is often a very sensitive issue. We, for example, had some videos where we bashed some Republican senators, such as Senator Shelby from Alabama, and of course, then we're instantly libtards. Then, for example, regarding Space Force or the 2024 moon landing date for the Artemis moon missions, we defended the current administration and bashed some Democrat Congress people, and bam, we are right-wingers. It seems that nowadays there's only black and white, zero and one, and nothing in between. Thus, of course, this topic is extremely sensitive and we will do our best to remain neutral because we are neither zero nor one, we are somewhere in between. But we must be talking about it because Election Day in the US is drawing near, and as you can imagine, the outcome probably will have a profound impact on the future of government-led space exploration.
And we emphasize that we are talking about government-led space exploration here. SpaceX is its own beast, and we are pretty sure that Elon will just continue developing Starship, no matter if Trump or Biden wins. SpaceX will just continue building Starship and Super Heavy as if nothing happened. Because as you know, Starship is entirely funded by SpaceX, except for the laughable $135 million which they received from NASA to develop a moonlander version of Starship. But the key for Starship is of course the massive revenue from Starlink, which will go online early next year. By 2024, Starlink will most likely already generate $30 to $40 billion annually, which is around twice the annual budget of NASA. That's why SpaceX will win in the end, no matter what politics will be doing. We will very likely have a SpaceX Moon and Mars base in any case. However, the outcome of the election will of course have an impact on NASA. NASA is a government agency, and thus extremely dependent on politics. So then, let's start with the Artemis moon program. What would happen to Artemis if Biden wins in November? Would NASA's Artemis moon program get canceled, as many people believe, and we ourselves once believed?
We think no, because landing the first woman on the moon would be a big political win for the Dems and very much in line with their policies. However, we are pretty sure that this will mean that the 2024 moon landing date will get postponed. Already now, bills have been proposed in Congress, such as the bill HR 5666, which has not passed the Senate yet, but this bill is already a good preview of what the Dems have planned, since it is heavily supported by the Democrat side of Congress. It would foresee postponing the Artemis moon landings to the late 2020s, keeping the lunar gateway, and shifting away the focus from the moon to Mars. The Artemis program is already quite well developed, and the contracts for the lunar gateway are already in place. Of course, our favorite lobbyist companies are building it, namely Boeing and Lockheed. Thus, we can be pretty sure that the gateway will be built, no matter who wins. And please consider subscribing to our channel because we are one of the very few channels openly talking about space politics, and we really need your support to continue to do so. Thank you very much.
Since the lunar gateway allows for a moon landing with a reusable moon lander, moon landings will happen in the 2020s under either administration. But of course, the 2024 landing date is politically motivated. If Trump wins a second term, the landing date would fall into his term. This would of course be a huge political win for him, and would be quite historical, considering the current economic situation, and that this would mean much higher annual costs for NASA. We are quite sure that this landing date would be more like 2026, or even as late as 2028, under a new administration. And chances for an Artemis moon base would shrink a lot, because the moon wouldn't be the focus anymore as it appears in current drafts, but more likely Mars, which is quite hilarious since NASA doesn't have anything even remotely capable of reaching Mars, nor will it have the necessary funding to build any spacecraft capable of reaching Mars in the next 10 years. And let's be realistic. The Lunar Gateway is far too small to be a viable backbone for any interplanetary spacecraft. So most likely, NASA will also realize this and continue focusing on the moon itself in the late 2020s, in both scenarios. In the Trump winning scenario, however, the 2024 landing might lead to a renewed moon race and might give us a moon base faster than in the Biden universe. However, we shouldn't forget that SpaceX will build a moon base either way in the mid-2020s. So yeah, probably a NASA moon base will become obsolete anyways at some point. Okay, so under both election outcomes, the moon will realistically remain the focus of NASA for the next 10 years at least. For lack of budget. But what about SLS and Orion? Well, only recently, ex-NASA Administrator Charlie Bolden said that SLS will soon go away. So we suspect that both under a Biden and Trump administration, the likelihood is extremely high that the whole SLS and Orion architecture cannot be kept up. If Starship and Super Heavy become fully operational and demonstrate a safe and secure capability to launch astronauts to low Earth and lunar orbit, we believe that at the latest, by 2023, with the Dear Moon lunar round-trip mission, the point will have come where even politics will realize that SLS cannot be kept up much longer. In the Trump timeline, this might lead NASA to use Starship for the 2024 moon landing. In the Biden timeline, since now the return to the moon wouldn't be seen as so pressing anymore, this might mean that Starship will land on the moon around 2024 without NASA.
But this gets into really speculative territory now, and we of course could be wrong about that. It could also happen that in both universes, Starship will land on the moon without NASA, since NASA will be slow and bureaucratic in both cases. But we can say with a high degree of certainty that in both universes, SLS and Orion will get cancelled probably around 2023, but only if Starship shows that it can perform a few successful missions with humans on board. In both universes, we will have the totally useless Lunar Gateway circling the moon, which is in a hilarious twist of events launched by Falcon Heavy, as has been announced earlier this year. In both universes, SpaceX will build a moon base, making the Lunar Gateway obsolete. However, it could be that in the Trump timeline, the Artemis moon base will be built by SpaceX, following the 2024 moon landing. Regarding Mars, in both timelines, NASA will just not have enough resources to do their own Mars missions and will have to rely on the Starship. In both timelines, we are pretty sure that the first manned Mars missions will be private SpaceX Mars missions, optimistically in 2024, but with possible delays. Only later would then NASA join in, after they see that SpaceX has shown the capability to land humans on Mars. In both timelines.
So, as you can see, no matter which timeline you prefer more, depending on your political preference, the end result won't be so extremely different, thanks to SpaceX. The only major difference we see here is that NASA would return to the moon later in a Biden timeline. Thus, in this scenario, SpaceX would likely land on the moon by themselves, without NASA. On the other hand, in a Trump timeline, the 2024 moon landing would probably happen under a NASA mission. possibly with Starship, but maybe also with one of the other two moon landers. So here you have it. Thanks to Elon and SpaceX, this will be the first time where the government won't play a big role anymore in space exploration. Thank you so much, Elon, for freeing human spaceflight from the shackles of idiotic politics.
Elon is working towards that goal, as we know, at Boca Chica, trying to develop the Starship as fast as possible to land on the moon in the next years. And on Mars, maybe already as soon as 2025 with luck, no matter who is president. And things are progressing nicely, so it doesn't even seem so unrealistic anymore. Starship SN8, as we know, is already being prepared for the 20-kilometer hop by receiving aerodynamic surfaces. The hop date is now set for October. Yeah, you didn't really believe Elon's overly optimistic tweet from last week, did you? This was of course Elon time, so October seems a lot more realistic. Apart from that, we can see so many nose cones already being pumped out from the nose cone production facility, it's insane. Meanwhile, SN5 and 6 are sheltered in the high bay, which gives us a really good impression of the gargantuan size of this building and how insane the Super Heavy booster is going to be.
In our last space report from Saturday, which you can check out right here, we talked about a new amazing research on the potential discovery of life in the clouds of Venus. And now, NASA is pondering how they could explore this fascinating planet again. And one really cheap and effective way would be to use chipsats. Chipsats are basically really small circuit boards, which could be deployed by the hundreds into Venus's atmosphere, and which would then collect massive amounts of data with lots of sensors. Of course, including the presence of microbial life. Fascinating! And many more mission types are of course on the drawing board now at NASA. But either way, we are glad to see a renewed interest in Venus now.
But before we continue, please take a moment for our sponsor message. I know you want to skip, but believe us, this stuff is good.
Today's video is sponsored by NordPass. So NordPass is the easiest and most convenient way to store all the passwords and to secure all your different accounts, credit card details, private notes, and much more, in a very uncomplicated and straightforward way.
Now we know exactly what you will think.
Are you insane? How can you give your passwords to someone else?
We used to write down every single password, but NordPass convinced us otherwise. It uses a zero-knowledge architecture, which means that your data is encrypted on your device before it reaches the NordPass service, where it is backed up and synced. NordPass thus doesn't know your passwords. Plus, NordPass is powered by NordVPN cybersecurity professionals with a lot of experience in the market.
Shopping online is probably the best example. NordPass will automatically generate extremely complicated passwords with lots of different character combinations. Once the password is saved, you can simply click on the NordPass icon to autofill the password and thus easily log into your account with just a few clicks. Of course, NordPass will also remember your credit card details, thus saving you even more time. So keep your passwords safe and organized and download NordPass for free. Yes, for free, today at nordpass.com. So thanks for watching today's sponsored message. And if you want to know why we think Dynetics moon lander is so much better than the national team's moon lander, you can watch this video right here.
So thanks for watching the JS Space Report, and then I would say, on to the future. How could I say this?
In space exploration, I can try it again. Dynetics versus Blue Origin lobby lander, right? Mm-hmm.